Say, neighbor.
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 Why have you been just lying here?
Why have you been just lying here?
Until this day, the ministry of Jesus had been largely unnoticed by the Jewish religious leaders. Though he had done miracles, his fame had not spread across Israel. The miracles that Jesus had performed were centered mostly around the areas of Judea and Galilee. There was the first miracle that he performed at the wedding in Cana, where Jesus turned the water to wine. The other recorded miracles is in the first three chapters of John, are the nobleman's son in Capernaum. On this day, Jesus would offend the religious leaders. He would begin a long journey to the cross by denying the laws of man and even going against the laws of the Sabbath. He would begin to show that he was the Lord of the Sabbath, and he would begin to manifest his supernatural power to see men free like he had never done before. As Jesus entered to the sheep gate, the first thing that catches his eyes that afternoon was the five porches all around, surrounding the pool. The heart of Christ was shrunken at the sight and the sounds of what he heard. People were moaning, groaning, suffering, just lying around and waiting. Wonder how much Jesus grieved at the sight of all the suffering of humanity. For these were Jews, God's chosen people in the earth. A people who called to glorify God and to show the world that there is truly a God who cares, a God that loves, a God of mercy, a God of grace, and the sovereign Lord of all creation that has power over all things, who rules the universe by the words of his mouth. I don't know about you this morning or how you would feel, but after seeing all this suffering of these people of God's chosen nation lying around the pool of suffering and hoping beyond hope for some miracle, I just simply don't see the glory in it. In the eyes of the world and all the heathen nations that surround Israel, this sight would have not been much of an inspiration to make me want to know the God of Israel. Now knowing the heart of Jesus as we do today from the perspective of being a part of the family of God, we still sometimes have a challenge understanding why God allows so much pain and suffering in this world. But we also know that it isn't God that brings the pain. We bring it upon ourselves through our own rebellious actions. Had it not been for the sin that is found in the heart of every man from Adam to today, this world would have never known the suffering, pain, sickness, disease, and death. But for the grace of God and mercy of God, man would have long ago disappeared from the face of the earth. But because God loved man so much, he has provided what we need to continue to flourish in spite of ourselves. Let us not forget that God's promise cannot fail, and his word will never cease to come to pass. In the very beginning, God told Adam and Eve to multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it, to become masters of all creation, and under the direction of the Holy Spirit, who would teach them all things. God's intentions for us, for mankind, has not and will never, ever change. Only the fulfillment of it all has been delayed for a time until the power of sin and the darkness is forever broken. On this day, as Jesus looked upon the suffering at the pool, his heart was grieved for the suffering he saw. There was a blind, there was a palsy, there was those withered limbs, paralyzed bodies, those who could not hear, not speak, or who were unable to move from one place to another. No doubt there was a lot of activity as those who cared for the sick and dying went from a person to person doing what they could, but this just simply reminds us that the ability to help man, the ability of man to help another is always limited. There is a pain that we cannot heal. There's a suffering that we have no power to control. Even in our best efforts, using the best medicine and the latest technology, there's a suffering that can't be stopped until death brings its sweet relief. Understand that death is an act of love that God gives to the suffering mankind. Death is a terrible thing, but to suffer in a disease-ridden, pain-filled body forever would be far worse. It is the love of God that limits the suffering that man would have to do in this body. The suffering of fallen man is what Jesus saw. I can only imagine how his heart must have ached for those lying around without hope. It didn't have to be this way. All it would have taken for this to have never happened was for man to have been faithful to God and to have not fallen to sin and become in league with the powers of darkness. I can understand that Jesus was troubled on this day. Man had brought it on himself, but that still didn't keep Jesus from being saddened by the condition of those at the pool. look around the world today and sometimes right here in the house of God, and I see so many who are in the same condition as those of people who are around the pool. Not a day goes by when we fail to hear of someone else's pain, someone else's suffering. Our world is filled with people who need both pity and mercy. It is though the entire world now was a great pool of Bathsheba, and everywhere you look, there is nothing but suffering. Come to this point and declare that we need a visitation of Jesus once again. Need that grieving heart of the Savior to walk among us and to lift us up at a place where we have been laid for so long. We cannot lift ourselves. There is no power in human flesh over that which is destroying the souls of man. The power to heal, deliver, it can only be found in the supernatural. The ability that only God can give. Can y'all say amen? The power of sin has captured the soul of man. They cannot seem to walk with God. They cannot hear the voice of God. They cannot understand the leading of the Spirit. And they don't perceive the word of the Bible because it all must come from God. Flesh cannot break through to the supernatural realm without the grace and the mercy of God to open our eyes and to ears that we must see and hear the supernatural. To hear the story of the angel is very interesting because the Bible says that this angel comes down in a certain season and stirs the water in the pool. Yes. This simply means that the opportunity to get into the water was always there, but unless the water was being stirred by the angel, it had no power to do anything at all. Yes. It was the presence of the angel, the Lord, that made the difference. What it just happened to mean by which men could touch the supernatural power of God. Without the supernatural power of God at work, there was no healing in the water, no deliverance, and no salvation. This just simply reminds us that it is not by might, nor by power of man, but by the Spirit of God. And only that supernatural power to overcome can be made manifest in the church. We can't conjure up the Holy Spirit. We can't fake it. We can't pretend, but it's only when the Lord and the Holy Spirit comes down and meet us here that the supernatural begins to happen. There's a lot that's going on in our churches today. There's nothing more than fleshly works. Things men have tried to manufacture to make it seem that the Spirit of God is moving, but there's no supernatural power. So the time for playing church is over. We must form a godliness with the power. We must form a godliness supernatural power and then become one with God in this season. Too many signs on the marquee say come and experience the Holy Spirit with us, but the Spirit has departed the church a long time ago. We can stir the waters with our music. We can stir the waters with our eloquent speeches. We can stir the water with our shouts and our dancing and our programs, but unless the angel of the Lord, the presence of the Holy Ghost is really there, there is no supernatural power to deliver, saved, and set free. Men will come in and go unchained, untouched, still trapped in sin and darkness. Only with their conscience soothed for a short period of time, having been deceived into believing that all is well. But as soon as they step outside the door, hell smacks them right back in the face. We need never needed a time for the Lord to move in our churches. It is now. Jesus looked upon the multitude of the suffering people. His eyes settled upon one man in particular. Out of them all, I wonder why that was. The question they asked, why is it that Jesus decided to point this man out? Could it have been the man's faith? Could it have been that Jesus knew that he would be receptive and believing? Understand, you see, that everybody isn't receptive to healing. Everybody isn't receptive to faith because their faith has been tainted by the acts of the enemy. So they don't have the faith to believe that God can bring them out. Jesus looked upon this man who had been laid there by the pool for 38 years. Understand that that's a lifetime of suffering and waiting for the supernatural of God. Jesus looked upon him through eyes of mercy. This was a man that was created in God's very own image. A man who had suffered the worst that life could throw at him. And a man that needed grace, that needed mercy and grace to help him in his time of need. The very heart of God was moved with compassion, and Jesus initiated the miracle. I wonder really quickly, y'all, I told y'all I won't be crazy, how many people in here would say that we sound a lot like this man who was laying by the pool for so many years, stuck in a place, waiting for some kind of some kind of sign that wanted to happen, but we've been stuck lying in the same place, and Jesus Christ has been in the room all along. Is there anybody here saying that I am a lot like this man, where I've been sick, I've been broken, I've been tore up, messed up on the floor, but all I needed to do was reach out to Jesus. We see here in the text that what Jesus does is Jesus goes to the man and he asks him one simple question, and then followed with a statement and said, take up your mat and walk. I wonder tonight how many people would be receptive to God's miracle in this room this morning. I wonder this morning how many people would be receptive to the miracles of God that's about to begin to flow in this ministry. I wonder how many people would be receptive to the supernatural powers that's beginning to share in this room, even as to the fact that God is about to send a miracle to your household, a miracle to your job, a miracle to your schools, a miracle, and that God's about to do some things that blows your mind. I wonder this evening and this morning how many people would be receptive to the fact that God is about to change some stuff in your life, that God's about to bring you out of some stuff, that God's about to bring you through some stuff. This thing that's been holding you and having you held and have been holding you down for all this long, God is saying, I'm here right now. But all you have to do is reach up and grab it. That miracle that you need, reach up and grab me. That healing that you need, reach up and grab me. Those finances that you need, reach up and grab me. That money that you need for your bills, reach up and grab me. Everything you need, God says you can get it right here in this moment. So I have a quick question for you. As I get ready to take my seat, I told you I won't be long. Why in the world have we just been lying here when the King and the Kings and the Lord of Lords is here in this building? Why in the world have we just been lying here when the author and finisher of our salvation has been here in this building? Why in the world have we just been lying here when the man who made the water and created the angel is here in this building? Why in the world have we just been lying here when the God who created the elements that made the medicine is here in this building? Why in the world have we just been lying here when the man who made the doctor and gave him his name is here in this building? Why in the world have we just been lying here when the man who made the psychiatrist is here in this building? Why in the world have we just been lying here, Refuge? I've come tonight to declare that you're waiting and your dry days are over. God says now it's time for you to take up your mat, Refuge, God, Church of God in Christ, and come on with me, because where I am, there is no sickness. Where I am, there is no mental abuse. Where I am, God says, the time is now. Okay, now, as we go and we look at the text, I can, like, after this man gets his mat and he gets up and walks, I can almost hear him singing the song, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was once lost, but now I'm found. I was once blind, but now I see. I wondered this morning if anyone was saying that that's going to be my testimony. I was once out, and I was once messed up. But God came in this moment and pulled me out of the mess. I wonder how many of y'all would say that that's my testimony. I was once full of sin, but God came and he picked me up. I wonder how many of y'all would say that that's my testimony. No more hatred in the heart, but we as a church will stand united and we will stop laying around. Do me a favor, y'all. I'm about to get out of here. Just do me a favor and stand to your feet and grab the hand of the person beside you and say, yo, it's time to get up from here. It's time to move forward. It's time to get on what God has for us. If you believe it, I dare you to begin to just hug your neighbor and say, neighbor, the time is now. I know you've been laying around for too long. I know it's been hurting to just lay here, but it's time to get up. It's time to get up. We've been laying here for too long as a church. We've been laying here for too long as a bishop. We've been laying here too long individual. Now is the time to take up our mats and get to what God has for us. If you believe it, just throw your hand back and say yes. Yes to my healing. Yes to my breakthrough.
through. Yes, you're my deliverance. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. My healing is now. My breakthrough is now. If you believe it, sir, and you got a sickness in your body, you ought to be reaching your hand up, saying that I need it now. Right now. Not tomorrow. Not next week. But what I need from God is right here in this moment. What I need from God is right now. I'm not waiting for those signs. I'm not waiting for the wonders. But what I'm waiting for and what I need is right here and right now.
But this morning on the way here, when I was rushing over from Providence, and I was trying to get here, which is a very long drive, the Lord began to speak to me, and he began to say that you need to tell the church that the miracles that they need is right here, right now. So many times we leave out of those doors still in pain, still suffering, still going through. But God says not this Sunday. Well, no, you guys don't know much about my gifts, but Lord's speaking to me even now where I know there's a person in here who has been dealing with back spasms to the point to where sometimes you can't get out of the bed. I hear the Lord saying that he's loosening up those muscles right now. There's another person in here. Now listen, my brothers know me, John also know me. If I wanted to, I can give you your name, social security number, and address. But I'm not going to do that because I feel like you need to acknowledge it for yourself, for that faith inside you to be activated. There's another person here who hasn't told nobody. I'm not calling names, I'm going to put you on spot because you've been keeping quiet about it. But there's a nervousness that you have because the doctor found some lumps. You haven't told anybody because you're a little nervous. I can tell you that your next doctor's appointment is March 17th. I believe it's a Friday. The Lord's telling me right now that if you go back, the doctors are going to find nothing. We said to our feet, but just remain in your feet. Because reality is that every single person in this room is battling with something. I can keep going around the room. But what I need you to do at this moment is have a little faith. If you're battling with a sickness, disease, whatever it may be, I want you to come down to the altar quickly. You're battling with some kind of health problems. I want you to come down to the altar because the Lord says the time for suffering is over. And the reason why the time for suffering is over is because now it's time for us to get to work. Quarterback can't throw the ball with a broken arm. He must recover first. God says that church has been in recovery mode and now it's time for us to get back in the game. Does anybody believe this?
Yeah.
Amen. Now, again, tell you exactly who you are. I can tell you exactly who you are. But if you don't activate your faith right now in this moment and come receive your healing and declare right now in this moment that you are healed.
Yes.
It's just all talk. Like, for example, the lady back here in the plaid shirt has been dealing with the chest pains. You ought to come get your healing. Shirt who has been going with some, dealing with them, some mental issues, like the devil's trying to take his mind. You ought to come get your healing. So I'm going to offer you the invitation one more time. I'm going to turn your service over. If you need healing in your body, in your mind, your soul, we need to be down here at this altar.
Thank you.
quick for a reason. What time is it? I'll give you 20 minutes. But there's some people that I've been wanting to pray for a really long time, and God's kind of just been revealing some stuff to me. And it bothers me because the invitation to the altar, listen, I'm not offended or anything like that, but I want to say that stop blocking your own miracle. Be real for a second.
Go ahead.
I promise y'all I'm not fussing. Just want to be real. Pastor Joe came and gave this invitation to the altar be packed. What happened is we focus on who has the mic and not focus on God and what God said. There's you're about to be blessed like never before. People may look at you and say that you're blessed now. That's God's, but God said because of your faithfulness to this church, to this leader, that you're going to receive an unexpected check within 22 days. I don't know where it's coming from. It's not really my business. But here's the instruction. God says that that's just the beginning. What I need you to do is when this check comes, I need you to take your 10% of the check, obviously, and sow it. And activate a little faith. It may be hard because I actually believe it's going to come during some hard times where he's like, you know what, I really need this and that boom is there. So it's going to be hard to give it up. God says, make sure you sow that 10%. Because that's just going to be blessing number one.
Yes.
Out of many. That's going to come back to back to back to back. Thank you for your faithfulness. God says thank you because he's going to reward you. He's going to bless you like never before. People may look at you and say that you're blessed now. They have no idea what God's about to do for you in your life.
Pray to God for yesterday.
I said you could have been in here. Don't keep going back. These doors wait to be open for you. Commit to God. I tell you the same thing I told him. The battle's not yours. It's the Lord's.
Yes.
And that's a beautiful thing because just it. It's already won. Why keep fighting a battle that's already won? Make sense?
You have won it all.
in spite of yourself, that he's still working stuff out in your heart.
Yes.
I says, I'm God all by myself. And even though you said, I'm not fussing, I'm just telling you what the Lord said. Even though you said, God says, because I am who I am. That I'm still going to heal you. I said, because I am that I am, that I'm still going to bless you. In spite of yourself.
There is power in the name. chain, break every 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 chain, yeah. Which causes us to stay in the same place, even when we come to the altar. Because we're moving physically, doesn't mean we're moving spiritually. You can come to the altar and stay in the same place. You can get happy, you can speak in tongues, you can foam at the mouth, you can run around the church and still be in the same place spiritually. Yes. And what God wants to do and is doing even now is break you free of that inertia in your spirit. And hear my spirit, the full leper said, why sit we here till we die? Why stay wrapped up and tied up in sin? Why stay in that situation? Why stay on drugs? Why stay on alcohol? Why stay in that situation when all it's doing is bringing you to death and destruction? Jesus spoke to us today.
Yes.
We don't need to remain in the same place. You don't need to remain in the same place. You need to rise up and walk. And the agent that causes you to rise and walk is Jesus Christ. He's the one who speaks to us, and his words are life. Giving and moves us out of our inertia, stands us on our feet, and even causes us to take up that which was taking care of us, that which was carrying us. He gives us the strength to pick that up and carry it. Hallelujah. The Lord has indeed moved in this place today. And what happens is we get used to it. We get used to coming down to the altar and crying. And we go right back home. We don't even wait till tomorrow. Do the same thing we did before we got to church. God wants to set you free of that. He wants to set you free of that inertia. He wants to set you free of making the church every now and then. He wants to set you free of being in the church and out the church. Set you free. He wants to make you whole. He wants to give you deliverance and bring you into the fold of his family. I'm not saying you have to be like me, but God wants to set you free from yourself. Lift those hands one more time and just begin to praise God for his deliverance. Thank God for the church. Thank God for the change in your life. Thank God for setting you free. Open those mouths and thank him. Yes. Let him have his way. 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 God's best for him to have his way. Can make you what you are to be. verse of the song says, would you live with Jesus and be always feeling good? Would you walk with him within the narrow road? Would you have him set you free so you need never fall? Let him have his way with thee. You want to be free? You can't do it on your own. You can't set yourself free. If you can set yourself free, Jesus would have never died. You cannot set yourself free. You can't do enough good. You can't do enough right to be free. The only person who can set you free is Jesus Christ. And he whom the Son sets free. Hallelujah. Let's praise God for the word and for the ministry. Amen. Thank you.